students, a very warm welcome to J English Ban Academy, India's leading and largest test preparation and education platform. Guys, we made this J English channel for you so that we can deliver content exclusively and exclusively in English for your JEE preparation and other competitive exams. And guys, you know what? We have the best in class faculty who have previously cleared IIT JEE and they know what you need to do to get through this competitive exams. And not only that, we'll take you from the basics and until the depth of every topic. And guys, so what are you waiting for? Click on that subscribe button, click on that bell notification to get timely updates. And for hustlers, it's a paradise, so you also can click on the subscribe button and bell notification. And guys, today we are going to explore current and electricity, one of the most interesting topic in physics. There are a hell lot of real life applications which is just based on this current and electricity. Your fan, your air conditioner, you know, even your small tiny products like phone and smartwatches, everything is based on these principles. And have you ever wondered how should be the electrical wiring of home be done, or is it done the correct way? We will discuss about this in this lecture. So stay tuned, stay along, and let me tell you something. Today we are going to discuss one of the most important topics of current electricity, which carries like a lot of weightage in your exams, and you can expect a couple of questions from this subtopic alone. And the speciality of current electricity is it is independent of each subtopics. Many times it is independent of each subtopics, and neither they are dependent upon rest of the topics in physics. So you can start from anywhere and you can still learn current electricity. And for people who know about me, well and good. I am Murali Dharan. I completed my MS in Electrical Engineering from University of Colorado Boulder. I am an electrical engineer and also an IITian who completed BTech from IIT Guwahati. I have 4 plus years of experience preparing students for IIT JEE and other competitive exams. I filed 22 plus patent applications in India, US and Canada. And today we are going to go through one of the most interesting topics in current and electricity, which is a part of electrical engineering as well. And even if you're a doctor, if you're, you know, like from other branches that you're aspiring for other branches, or if you're aspiring to be a doctor, still it's an awesome topic and it carries a good amount of weightage and it's a very interesting topic. So guys, we'll get into this and we'll explore this completely and we will tear it apart. We'll explore every bits and pieces of this topic, guys. And we have something really, really special for you guys. That is our special class, which is going to be streamed on Saturday from 4 to 6 p.m. And this is about how to score 99 percentile and above in your JEE physics. We are going to discuss those tricks, tips and strategies to score 99 percentile and above in JEE physics. And let me tell you, it's quite easy. All you need is a plan and, you know, the right kind of strategies to make it happen. So don't forget to come to this special class. It's a free special class by Unacademy and Unacademy JEE English. And guys, if you want to attend this class, you may want to go and download the Unacademy Learning app. And you can go and download this Unacademy Learning app from Play Store or App Store. And you can attend such free special live classes. Not only that, we have special live classes from top-notch educators across nation every now and then on this Unacademy Learning app. And guys, to know more about our channels, to get timely updates on our channels, you may want to go and click on this link https://t.me/jee_english and you'll be redirected to the Telegram channel, which is nothing but jee_english. Or if you have a Telegram app, you can just directly enter jee_english and you can find our Unacademy jee_english. And on this, we will provide you with timely updates on our class schedule, our video books, and also on any notes that we are posting on. So don't forget to get onto this channel and subscribe to this channel. And guys, this is one of those one-stop hassle-free solution to get all your timely updates in one place. And guys, if you're preparing for exam and you're looking for something special, we have a subscription and you can choose the program. If you're specifically preparing for IIT JEE as IIT JEE, you can set your goal as IIT JEE and get our subscription. And it is one of those awesome things where you get live quizzes, leaderboards, polls, and, you know, interactive sessions with our top-notch educators. And not only that, you also get to get your doubts cleared from these top-notch educators on this subscription. And the subscription hardly costs 1500 per month for a 24 month package, which makes quite a bit of sense for people who are in 8th, 9th, 10th or 11th class. And if you're a long term or a dropout, you may want to go for a 12 month package, which hardly costs 2500 per month. And if you're locked down and if you're looking for some resourceful, you know, like a platform where you want to get 6000 plus materials for your JEE preparation, we have that too. We have 1 and 3 month package, which hardly costs 6000 or 5000 per month. And guys, you can make use of my coupon Murali Live to get a 10% instant discount. You may want to explore this premium platform and I bet it's worth it. And guys, as usual, we are going to start from a quote from one of the renowned inventors in current and electricity, that is Thomas Alva Edison, who said that genius is only 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. Which means he's saying that it is about 99% hard work. It's not just about the inspiration. If you have 99% inspiration and a very little hard work, it is very difficult to achieve any success. But let me tell you something interesting about this topic. In this topic, you don't need 99% perspiration. All you need is 99% inspiration and rest will be taken care by us. And in fact, you need a little bit of perspiration. You need to practice problems. That is the key to solve problems, be it in current and electricity or any other topics in JEE physics or physics. And current electricity is actually a very, very interesting topic. Not only that, you know, it has a lot of real life applications. And in this topic, we are going to discuss something very interesting known as combination of resistance. We'll take it from the basics until the depth. So stay tuned, stay along, and we'll explore pretty much everything what is going to be asked in your JEE. I mean, like the model problems or the model concepts that are going to be asked in your JEE and other competitive exams. And we'll start a little bit with, you know, like a concept revision that we have learned earlier, which says, you know, like we have discussed that, you know, resistivity is inversely proportional to conductivity, where resistivity is a material property and conductivity is as well a material property, and resistivity is equal to 1 by conductivity. Conductivity is the ability of that material to conduct and resistivity is the nature of the material that obstructs the flow of electrons or any charges. Okay, resistivity is equal to 1 by conductivity, and resistivity is also dependent upon electron density per unit volume and relaxation time tau. Okay, resistivity is dependent upon two factors. One is number of free electrons per unit volume or electron density per unit volume, and tau, which is nothing but relaxation time. And the amount of, you know, the free electrons goes up, that means the resistivity is going to decrease and the ability of the material to conduct increases. And similarly, if the relaxation time goes down, that is, if these electrons get attracted more to the positive ions or they collide with the positive ions and they are rippling more and more of themselves, the relaxation time is low, then resistivity goes up and the ability to conduct goes down. So as this relaxation time increases, there is more time between collisions, or there's more time between these kind of, you know, movements and attractions, then what happens is the relaxation time increases, the resistivity goes down, the electrons are drifting more smoothly inside the lattice. And not only that, if you, you know, increase this, you know, relaxation time, or the relaxation time tau gets increased, then in that case the conductivity also goes up. As simple as that, because the ability to conduct of that material increases, or there are more free electrons on or charges to conduct. And what about resistance? Resistance is a material property which is dependent upon also dimensions. So resistivity is just a pure material property, whereas resistance is also dependent upon dimensions, and it is also a material property. I mean, it also, you know, the material property also influences resistance. And resistance is equal to rho into L by A. Resistance is equal to rho into L by A, where rho is resistivity and L is the length of the conductor that is conducting, or the length along which the current is traveling. Let's say this is the length of the, you know, conductor, and this is the flow of current. The current is flowing along the length. You consider this to be the length. And whereas area is the cross-sectional area across which this current or the current density is flowing. Okay, more aptly said, current is flowing. So let's say the current is flowing like this. Okay, you consider this entire flow through which it flows, this entire flow length as the length of the conductor, and whereas this entire area through which this current is passing, okay, that is called as the cross sectional area, and we consider this area, and resistance is inversely proportional to this cross sectional area. As and when this cross sectional area increases, the resistance of that material decreases. And similarly, if you constrain the length, if you decrease the length, the resistance will go up. Okay guys, it's pretty intuitive, pretty easy. The relationship between what is resistivity, the relationship between resistivity and conductivity, and also the relation between resistance and resistivity. Resistance is not purely a material property, it is also dependent upon dimensions. Whereas resistivity is a pure material property where temperature influences the material's resistivity and resistance as well. So what happens when I'm increasing, of a metal or a metal conductor, if I increase the temperature of a metal or a metal conductor by delta T, the resistance also increases. And how does it increase and what is it dependent upon? The resistance, the increase in resistance is dependent upon two factors. One is the initial resistance and the other one is an alpha. And the third one is the delta T. Okay, whereas alpha is constant, alpha is nothing but the temperature coefficient of resistance, delta T is the change in temperature. Okay guys, delta T is change in temperature, alpha is the coefficient or the temperature coefficient of resistance. Okay, and what about R naught? R naught is the initial resistance from which you are heating or supplied in heat to that material. Okay, so if you increase the temperature of a conductor by delta T, the resistance is also going to increase, and it is proportional to the initial resistance and the increase in temperature and its material property, which is nothing but temperature coefficient of resistance. So there are three things: how much you are increasing the temperature also influences the final resistance, the alpha, the temperature coefficient of the material, also influences this resistance, and R naught, which is nothing but the initial resistance from which you are heating, and before heating there is some particular resistance of that metal or the metal conductor, right, that also influences the final resistance after the delta T increase in temperature. This is a very crucial concept. In fact, this concept, we even discussed this concept a little bit, ugly in the last class, and that being said, it is also written in many places that way. Okay, it is very important to understand this expression that the resistance, the final resistance or the resistance, is dependent upon the initial resistance from which you are increasing the temperature or the resistance at which you have supplied the heat, and the alpha, the temperature coefficient of resistance, and the delta T, the increase in temperature. So all these three factors influence the final resistance after delta T increase in temperature. And that being said, my sincere apologies. We in fact did not discuss this concept properly in the last class. Last class we said that, let's first get started with this concept and understand this expression, so that we will, understand what has gone wrong. So let's say we have plotted temperature on x-axis and resistance on y-axis. So in this case, let's say the intercept, the y-intercept is R naught, which is nothing but the initial resistance from which you have supplied that delta T. Then what would be the slope? The slope would be alpha into R naught, not just alpha, guys. In the last class, we discussed this for a few minutes, that the slope would be alpha. But while solving the any problems around them, we got the answer correct because we made use of the expression. Okay, we made use of the expression. There should not be delta over here, so this should not be delta. Should be alpha into just T minus T naught. So the thing is, see, the slope in this case, when I'm plotting the temperature on the x-axis, and the resistance on the y-axis, then in that case, the y-intercept for that delta T temperature increase from R naught. Okay, I'm repeating that statement again. For that delta T increase in temperature from or not would have a graph like this. Okay, and in this graph, what would happen is the slope would be equal to alpha into R naught, not just alpha, because the change in resistance is dependent upon both the initial resistance and alpha, and also the delta T increase in temperature. Okay, and if given any equation or given any problem around these kind of graphs, you should be really be careful that you include the R naught. Okay, students, R naught should be included when you're writing down this expression or calculating the slope. In fact, in the problem, what was given was like R by R naught on the x-axis and temperature on the y-axis. So what happened is when we were writing this, you know, like this expression, the delta T was, you know, given on the y-axis. So what we wrote is like y is equal to mx plus c form, where we got 1 by alpha as the slope. Okay. Here it is the normal graphs that you see in experiments and all. And people generally assume that even in many materials or books it is written that slope is nothing but alpha. But it should be alpha into R naught. And given in an exam, there is no hint on R naught, you are going to consider just the slope as alpha. Or you may appeal to your examiner saying that, you know what, this should be alpha into R naught, please have a look at the expression. It's best to go by the expression and your understanding of the concept rather than, you know, just the, you know, like memory of the graph or something. Okay, sometimes it is better not to just, you know, memorize the graphs. It is better to understand the concept of the graph, how the slope should be derived. And similarly, you should be noticing such mistakes in any classes or any books. Okay, and that being said, like this graph is only valid when I am calculating for a delta T increase in temperature. Okay, delta T increase in temperature from R naught. Let's say I am changing the temperature, then this, the initial temperature, if I'm heating from some other temperature, this graph is still valid. This should be the slope, but it would be a little different. Okay, but that is saying mathematically, but understand from the physics point of view, like it is going to be dependent upon R naught. You can basically equate that equation to R naught and finally get it in terms of R. So you need not worry about that. But the thing you have to remember is slope is equal to alpha into R naught. It is proportional to, of course, alpha, the temperature coefficient of resistance, but it is also proportional to the initial resistance R naught. Okay guys, this should be clear. You can also, you know, sort of understand that equation understand that graph from this equation, R is equal to R naught plus alpha into, you know, delta T, where I'm saying R minus R naught is like, you know, Y minus Y naught. Okay. And I'm calling T minus T naught as the change in temperature, or the temperature Y is equal to mx plus C thing. So in this case, I can just say R minus R naught, but m will be A into R naught. Okay, because this R naught will get multiplied by the second term as well. It won't be just be multiplied by the first term. So you'll write, when you're writing it, you'll write it as R minus R naught, right? Just a moment, guys. Yeah. So when you're writing it as, you know, R minus R naught. So let's say, So let's say when I'm writing this expression, I'm writing it as R minus R naught is equal to R naught into alpha into T minus T naught. Okay. When I'm writing this expression, what would happen? It would be R minus R naught. This R naught will come on the other side, but it will be also be multiplied with alpha. So slope would be alpha into R naught, where on the other side would be R minus R naught into alpha into R naught into T minus T naught. Pretty intuitive, pretty easy from the expression. As if you are going by, you know, just the memory of graphs, it can go wrong. And my sincere apologies, this was, you know, not discussed properly in the last class and we have corrected it. Please do remember this. And what about identifying the materials from the nature of alpha or the temperature coefficient of resistance? Metal generally has an alpha greater than zero. That's why I was very, very specific that, you know, we are talking about metal conductors when I'm writing 1 plus alpha into delta T. Or you can just substitute the original value of alpha for semiconductor, still it's going to be negative. But the thing you have to, you know is like, in semiconductors, the alpha is going to be negative, which means increase in temperature, the conductivity is going to increase and the resistance is going to decrease. Okay, as you increase the temperature, the conductivity is going to increase in semiconductors because there will be more availability of electron hole pairs and the relaxation time is not a significant value that is influencing the resistance or the conductivity in cases of semiconductors. So the more, you know, predominant value in semiconductors is going to be the free electron density n, which has increased drastically. That means when this free electron density has increased drastically, the resistivity would go down. And the alpha for semiconductor, if you work it out, it would be negative. And the alpha for semiconductor is generally in the range of minus 0.07 to minus 0.05 Kelvin inverse. And remember this, guys, the unit of alpha is Kelvin inverse. And for metals, the alpha is greater than 0 and they are in the order of 10 to the power minus 3 or, like, you know, 5 into 10 to the power minus 3 Kelvin inverse. And there is a special kind of, you know, metal alloys for which alpha is literally 0, not 0 but near 0. And the range of alpha for this metal alloys is generally the range of, you know, 10 to the power minus 4 Kelvin inverse. And what does this say you? Even if you increase the temperature a lot, the resistance is going to change very little in cases of this special alloys. And if you plot a graph between, you know, the change in temperature and, you know, like resistance or resistivity, you see that, you know, this graph will have a very small slope. And for insulators, the alpha is nothing but 0, which means it has high resistivity in the range of 10 to the power 8 to 10 to the power minus 15. And this should be, this unit should not be Kelvin inverse but ohm meter. You remember this, guys, this unit should be ohm meter. Okay, this should not be Kelvin inverse but ohm. Okay, meter, because I just started repeating the Kelvin inverse and it went wrong, I guess, but this should be ohm meters. And insulators have alpha 0 means they can, their, you know, resistivity or conductivity is not going to change with any increase or decrease in temperature. This is because insulators just do not conduct. They have very much high resistivity in the range of 10 to the power 8 to 10 to the power 15 ohm meter. Okay, guys. So this alpha literally tells you whether it's a metal, semiconductor or the special kind of metal alloys or insulator. And talking about, you know, metals, they have alpha greater than 0, semiconductors have alpha less than 0, metals have alpha greater than 0 because there is a lot of collisions between the electrons and, you know, the positive ions, and that is going to increase the resistivity a lot. Similarly, in case of semiconductors, number of free electron hole pairs are more. That means, I mean, it is more of a significant effect than the relaxation time, and in fact the relaxation time does not get affected much. Hence, the alpha is less than 0 and with increase in temperature, the resistivity will decrease. And for metal alloys, they are much indifferent towards increase in temperature. But even if they are, you know, affected by increase in temperature, it's a very, very, you know, small, like not a very significant change or a very small change. In case of insulator, alpha is literally 0 because they cannot conduct and the resistivity is very high. I hope these concepts are clear, and we will soon get into, like, the topic that we have come here for today, and that's going to be more interesting. And these are some important concepts that we need to know and we should understand. And if given a graph, how do you identify, if given a graph between, you know, temperature and resistivity, how do you identify whether it's a metal, semiconductor, special alloy or superconductor? In metal, as you know, the conductivity, you know, in metal, the resistivity is directly proportional to temperature and the conductivity is inversely proportional to temperature. That means if you increase temperature, the resistivity should increase in sort of a linear manner. Okay, it may vary from, you know, metals to metals, but this is how this, you know, general graph for metals would look like. With increase in temperature, with an increase in temperature, the resistivity also increases. Okay, that is metals, that is about metals. And what about semiconductors? In semiconductors, with increase in temperature, the resistivity should decrease. and the graph would look in the form of y is equal to 1 by x graph. This is y is equal to m by x graph, isn't it? So it will look like a y is equal to 1 by x graph, and in cases of special alloy, they will have very small slope, okay, or maybe not some any slope when the resistivity is plotted against temperature. You'll have a very small slope, and these are like few special alloys. Not all alloys are meant to be like that. There are few special alloys like nichronium, constantan. These alloys have very small alpha or near zero alpha, which does not which does not allow resistivity to change much with temperature. And what about superconductors? As the name states, superconductor at certain temperature, that is below certain temperature, will have infinite conductance or no resistivity. Infinite, conductivity or conductance and no resistivity. And that temperature we call it critical temperature, and below that temperature the resistivity is zero. And at the temperature suddenly the resistivity drops to zero. Okay, this is the temperature, like let's assume this is the temperature, and at this temperature the resistivity would suddenly become zero for superconductors. Okay, that's why they are called superconductors. Okay, you can now identify from the graph, whether given a graph between resistivity and temperature, you can identify whether it's a metal, semiconductor, special alloy or superconductors. And guys, what about if I plot different temperatures, if I plot V versus I graph, okay, for different temperatures, if I plot V versus I graph, you notice that for metals, resistance would increase the temperature. That means this is the higher temperature in metals. Okay, in metals, in this case, which has higher slope would be the higher temperature. And in cases of semiconductor, it would be the other way around. With increase in temperature, the resistivity should decrease. Because in this case, if you see the slope is nothing but, if you take tan theta of this or of this theta, then you'd understand that there's nothing but resistance. Because tan theta is going to be y by x, which is nothing but b by m. So that would be like for, for higher temperature, the semiconductors would have lesser slope, whereas for a lower temperature, the semiconductors would have higher slope. So in this case, T2 is greater than T1 for semiconductors. But whereas for conductors, the resistivity and the resistance should increase with increase in temperature. So the one that is having higher slope or the higher resistance is at the higher temperature. Okay, for metals, the T1 is the higher one. And guys, there was an interesting question yesterday. So one of the students asked me, so does semiconductor really follow Ohm's law? Okay, see, until certain field, it follows Ohm's law, or it would have, V is equal to I, as, there would be a linear relationship between V and I. But beyond the temperature, beyond the saturation voltage, the resistance would remain constant, or the current would become independent of the voltage or the resistance. So what happens in semiconductor is beyond certain field, it will not follow Ohm's law, and you will not see a graph like this, a linear graph like this. Okay, that's a very interesting question. But remember that if I increase the temperature, the resistance has still decreased for semiconductors. Okay, let's do an interesting question. We have been talking all about resistors. But what is this resistors? Resistors are generally nothing but metal conductors or conductors. Okay, guys. And now let's do a question where two metal conductors are joined in series or along their length. Okay, this is not exactly series. So you say you take one conductor of different length, and you take another conductor of different length but of the same material, and if you join them, what would happen? What would be the effective resistance P? Okay, so there is this material A which has resistivity rho, length L1 and area A. This material B, which has same resistivity and same area rho and A, but different length L2. Okay, and they are joined along the length, or they are connected along the length. So now what would be the effective resistance of this combination? A and B. How do you calculate that? You simply know the length has increased. The area remained constant and the resistivity did not change since it's the same kind of material. So in that case, the resistance, the net resistance is going to be nothing but rho into L by A, and in this case L is going to be L1 plus L2. So the R net in this case is going to be rho into L1 plus L2 by A. Okay, because area remained the same and it is of the same material rho. So the rho will also remain constant. But the thing that has changed is length. Now, what can I do? Can I write it mathematically as rho into L1 by A plus rho into L2 by A? Can I write this way? Isn't it? Can't I write it this way? So if I write it this way, what is rho into L1 by A? Nothing but resistance of the material A. Whereas rho into L2 by A is nothing but resistance of material B. So we found some relationship when, you know, like two materials of the same material quality and same area are connected across the length with different lengths. If they are connected across the length, we found that R net is equal to RA plus RB. Okay. For this, both this, you know, given resistors or, you know, materials, or like, let's call it any sort of, you know, resistor, should have same material property rho, and they have, you know, same area, cross sectional area A, and if they are connected across the length, then you find that R net would be nothing but addition or the sum of the resistances. And if you even, you know, like, continue attaching such many resistors of the same material, okay, if you continue attaching many resistors of the same material, of same area, cross sectional area, but of different length, you will still find that this relation R net is equal to sum of all the resistances would hold true. Okay, it's an interesting concept. If given, you know, just, you know, like, two materials with resistivity, you do it this way. Okay, and now let's talk about a different case. What I'm doing is, in this case, I have two resistors of same material quality, and same material property, and they have same lengths, but they are connected across cross sectional area. Now the cross sectional areas varying. We are seeing that, you know, we'll see that, you know, like, how the net resistance be influenced. Okay, so what would you do? You know that the cross sectional areas changed. So you would just, you know, try to find out the relationship between the cross sectional area, the total cross sectional area and the net resistance. So this, the cross sectional area would be A1 plus A2. Length is the same, so length would remain same. Materials are same, so it would remain R. R would be not influenced by rho. And what would be the value of R net? R net, or the total resistance, would be equal to rho into L by A1 plus A2. Okay guys, so if I am trying to find the net resistance of this combination A and B, where, you know, this resistor A and resistor B have same material property and same cross, the length, but different cross sectional area, then can't you write this R net is equal to rho into L by A1 plus A2. Continue. It's pretty, you know, intuitive, and it's pretty easy. Like, think about it, like, two materials are kept over each other. Now think that cross sectional area must have increased. If they have same length, but even if they have same area, still the cross sectional area would increase. Okay. And in this case, you would notice that the overall resistance of the material compared to individual materials has decreased, because the cross sectional area increased, which means the resistance should decrease. This combination is decreasing or reducing the resistance of the material, or the combination. Okay, not the material. Materials, you know, material does not have, you know, material has resistance, but material as such is generally indicated by resistivity, not resistance. Resistance includes, you know, dimensions. And in this case, we are specifically talking about the influence of the dimensions on, you know, the resistance. Okay guys, so in this case R net is equal to rho into L by A1 plus A2, where A1 is the area of material A and A2 is the area of material B or the resistor B. Okay, so now we know this thing that R net is equal to rho into L by A1 plus A2. If I take the inverse of R net and try to, you know, work around some mathematical manipulations, I'll find that, you know, let's say I've taken the inverse of R net and I've separated this A1 plus A2. Yes, separate terms. So in this case, I'm getting 1 by, you know, 1 by rho L into A1, and the second term would be A2 by rho by L. So which is nothing but RA, isn't it? 1 by RA, A1, so this term. So A by rho L is nothing but 1 by RA, isn't it guys? And similarly, A2 by rho L is nothing but 1 by RB, where RB is equal to rho into L by A2, B as area A2. And if you notice it, 1 by R net is equal to 1 by RA plus 1 by RB. Isn't it interesting? So what would you do if I give you, like, you know, two different resistors that have two different cross sectional areas, and let's say the length is also differing and they are, you know, like joined either along the length or across the area. See, you would calculate it for those individual spaces where, you know, there is no influence of length or area due to this the other resistor, and then you would include that in the final calculation where you are accounting the effect of the combination. Okay, this is just, you know, putting one material on another, or sorry, putting one resistor on another, or one material on another. Okay, pretty easy. And you also notice that in this case, when I'm connecting it across the cross sectional area, when they have same length, or even let's say they do not have same length, the overall resistance will go down. In this case, R net is greater than 1 by R net is greater than 1 by RA and 1 by RB, because RA and RB should be positive. So in this case, 1 by R net should be greater than 1 by RA and 1 by RB. That also means 1 by R net is less than either of 1 by RA. I mean, sorry, R net is going to be less than RA or RB, because 1 by R net is greater than either RA and 1 by R net is greater than 1 by RB. This implies that R net is going to be always less than RA and RB. Alright, we'll understand this concept even better while we'll get into this topic. And this is, you know, this is something that you need to understand to, you know, there may be questions around this, and this is something you need to understand what is happening when you're connecting resistors in parallel. Okay, this is just a material combination. We'll understand what is parallel, what is series as we move to this topic. Okay, so now we'll start understanding the series concept. So let's say I have three resistors, R1, R2 and R3. If I connect them on the same line, where I, you know, place R1 adjacent to R2 and they have a common connection, and I place R2 adjacent to R3 and I have a common connection, and let the charge flow, what would happen? The same charge entering should also exit. Or if you go by the, you know, like the theory of charge conservation, a charge entering a node should, you know, also exit at some point of that node. Same amount of charge should exit. If given only one, you know, line, if there are multiple lines, the case would change. But understand this, like charge entering a region or charge accumulating, or sorry, charge deaccumulating on a region should also accumulate. The same amount of charge should deaccumulate. So if you look at it, how did it look like? It looks something like this. So this charge Q1 is going through all R1, R2, R3. Okay, while coming back. Okay, so this charge Q1 is going through R1, R2, R3. This also means the same current is flowing through R1, R2, R3 when they are placed adjacent to each other and they have a common connection and they are connected to a battery. It's a closed circuit. That's when current flows. Okay. So this also tells me something. Okay, this potential has to drop within this circuit. So within this R1, R2, R3, assuming rest are just, you know, just wires without any resistance, this, you know, potential V should drop within R1, R2 and R3. This potential V should drop because this is plus V. If let's assume this battery is V and this is zero. So at the end of the circuit, the potential would become zero. That means this potential has to drop between this series combination. We call this series, then the resistors are connected this way. They have a common node or a common connection and they are placed adjacent to each other. Okay, and the speciality is the same current will flow through all the resistors in series combination. Okay, pretty easy. So now, if you understood that the same current is flowing through all these resistors, the potential drop is nothing but I into R1 plus I into R2 plus I into R3. Because here the potential, some potential IR1 would drop. Here some potential IR2 would drop. Here some potential IR3 would drop. So total potential drop has to be V. We know that. So V is equal to IR1 plus IR2 plus IR3. And same current is flowing through resistors connected in series combination. Okay, easy, pretty awesome. Now, have you noticed it? Let's say, what is the potential dropped across R1? It would be IR1. And across R2, it is going to be IR2. Across R3, it is going to be IR3. And these potentials are proportional to resistances. Which means, larger the resistance in a series connection, that resistance is going to have the maximum potential drop. The maximum potential drop for a bunch of resistors connected in a series combination, the most potential would drop across, considering just this individual resistors, the most potential would drop across the largest resistor or the resistor with the highest value. So let's say in this case, R2 is the largest resistor or the resistor with the highest resistance. So the maximum potential, the maximum means, what I mean to say by maximum is the most potential compared to R3 or R2 would drop across R2. Okay. So the most potential or the highest potential would drop across R2. Okay, let me correct it again. So not most potential, I should not say most potential, what should I have said is, you know, the highest potential would have dropped across R2. And not across R3 or R1, assuming that R2 is greater than R1 and R2. Pretty awesome concept, right? So if you connect a bunch of resistors in series and you notice that the resistor which has the highest value would consume the most potential, or the most potential would drop across, or the most voltage would drop across that resistor with highest resistance. Okay. Now we also know that, you know, this thing, let's call this V. Let's say this V is connected to some ideal resistor. An imaginary resistance. Let's call that, some R. And there would be some resistor where, this V is equal to I into R. Okay, let's say I have an imaginary resistor that I connected across this battery V, battery with potential difference V, or voltage V, or across this potential V. Then in that case, you would also notice that for some value of resistance, the same current would flow across the circuit. Or flow in the circuit. In that case, can I say that this R is nothing but R equivalent or R net? If I have these three resistors or this one resistors, is the same thing? That these three resistors in series combination, R1, R2 and R3, or just an R, okay, which also, you know, make sure that only current I flows through the circuit. In that case, I can call this, you know, like this resistor R, this ideal or this imaginary resistor R, as equivalent or net resistance. So what would be the value of the net resistance of the circuit is something that we can, you know, calculate from this kind of like model or let's say calculation. So in that case, can I write R net is equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3, because I into R net is equal to I into R1 in plus I into R2 plus I into R3, which means R net is equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3. Therefore, the resistors connected in series have net resistance sum equal to the sum of resistors. Okay. So that means, let's say I have bunch of resistors, like not just R1, R2, R3. I have like R1, R2, R3, R4, R5 until like, you know, Rn. Some, you know, like n be like some 100. R1, R2, R3, R4, R5, R6, R7 until R100. In that case, they are just connected in like, you know, series. Let's assume they are connected in series. In that case, what would be the net resistance? R1 plus R2 plus R3, R4 until you can, you know, you have to add until Rn. Or maybe that R100, that will give you the net resistance. You can, you know, place a resistance of the same value or a resistance of the same resistance to get the same current. Because in series, you know, like the current flown through all this resistors is the same. Okay. And we already, you know, understood that the potential drop across, you know, each resistor R1, R2, R3 is proportional to the, you know, I mean the voltage drop across R1, R2, R3 is proportional to R1, R2, R3 themselves. The voltage drop across R1, R2, R3 is proportional to the value of the resistance of the resistor R1, R2, R3. So higher the value of resistance, more the potential drop. Okay, and we just, you know, understood this concept where I said, you know, like if you have like, you know, n number of resistances just connected in series, not just three resistances or three resistors, in that case the net resistance would be equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3 plus R4 until Rn. And similarly, the potential drop across them, let's call the potential drop across V1 as R1 as V1, across R2 as V2, and across R3 as V3, and across R4 as V4, and so on until Rn as Vn. In that case, the potential drop across this, you know, resistors would be proportional to R1, R2, R3, R4, Rn, because the same current flows through them. Okay. Now let's understand the other side or the other kind of combination. So one is, you can place one way to connect this resistors is you can connect them, you know, with a common node or with a common, you know, connection, and then maybe you can connect them to a battery. The other way could be, you know, I connect both of them, have like, you know, I connect them both with a in a parallel combination or with two common connections or with, you know, same connections or common connections to the battery. Okay, in this case, if you see R1, resistor R1, resistor R2 and resistor R3 are connected parallel to each other. That means they have same common connections. I mean, they have common connections, not same common connections, they have common connections. This R1, R2, R3, R1, R2, R3 have common connections. And these common connections, let's say this common connection is 1 and this is some, you know, like 2, this 1 and 2 should have different potentials, assuming a current is flowing through them, or you know, you connect a battery to them. But the thing is, this ends of the resistors, like this end of R3, this end of R2, this end of R1, all have same potential. That is, what is the potential at one is going to be the potential at this end of R1, this end of R2, and this end of R3. And the same way also on the other end, let's say here at this point, whatever be the potential, it will be also be the potential at this point and at this point. That means at this end of R1 and at this end of R2 and at this end of R3, the potential is going to be the same. And what would be the current flown through them? The potential across the nodes of resistors connected in parallel is going to be same, the potential across the connections, or the connectivity points should be, I mean, the voltage drop across them should be the same when these resistors are connected in parallel. Now, how would the current flow, or how would the charges flow? Let's say Q amount of charges flows from, you know, from this starting point. Then these charges would get divided into different or equal value depending upon the value of resistors. In case of series, you observe that the same current was flowing through the resistors connected in series. Whereas in case of parallel connection, you see that a parallel combination, you see that the same current does not flow, but whereas both these ends of the resistors are at same potential. I mean, same potential means these ends, one end of the resistor is at the same potential of the of this resistor. So what I mean to say over here is, just reiterating it again, I know that. So over here, if you see this resistor R1, but it is a very important concept. You see this R1, it is connected to this point, and R2, this end is also connected to this point, and R3, this end is also connected to this point. Which means one end of R1, R2, R3 has the same potential, and also the other end also has the same potential. But these two ends are at different potential. These two, you know, connections are at different potential. So the voltage drop across the resistors connected in parallel connection is going to be the same. Okay. The potential drop across resistors connected in parallel connection is going to be the same. And the current is going to be different. The amount of charges per unit time is going to be different. But these charges has to somehow, you know, if they are connected in parallel and it's a closed loop connection, then only it's a connection, right? If it's an open loop connection, means that is infinite resistance. That means through that path, no current will flow. And if Q amount of charges enter this, you know, this particular place at some time t, and after some time t, it should also exit from the other end. Okay. So what happens in a parallel connection or a parallel combination of resistors? So there are a few key points. One, the initial charges that is flown into the parallel connection should be conserved. So at the end of the parallel connections, there should be the same amount of current. Okay. There should be the same amount of current. And this means if this much current is entering this node and the same current is exiting this node, this means different current should also flow through R1, R2, R3. Okay. And the sum of these current flown through R1, R2, R3, sum of the current flown through R1, R2, R3 should be equal to, let's call the initial current as I, should be equal to I. Isn't it? Okay. And what about the potential drop across the resistors connected in parallel? They should have same potential drop. So let's say, or let's find out rather, you know, this point, just a moment guys. So let's say this point would be at potential V. It is connected to plus V. This is plus. Okay. And this point is zero. And this point is connected to zero. If you see this, the potential V is just dropping. In this case of the circuit, the potential is dropping just across these three parallel combination of resistors. And the thing is, these ends of the resistors, or each end of these resistors, are at same potential. Each matching end of the resistors are at same potential. Here in this case it was V, and on the other side it was like zero in this case. Okay. In cases of parallel combination, the same potential is going to drop across the resistors, and in case of series combination, the same current is going to flow. So now let's say I want to find out the, you know, like the net resistance, or if I connect some resistor across this circuit instead of R1, R2, R3, I don't want to connect R1, R2, R3 in parallel combination. Rather, I want to connect some net resistance or some equivalent resistor that can, you know, supply the same amount of current. What would be the value of that resistor? How would we find that out? See, we already know the net current. Okay. Net current should be equal to I1, I2, I3, where I1 is the current flowing through resistor R1, and you know, like I2 is the current flowing through resistor R2, and I3 is the current flowing through resistor R3. That should be equal to the net current, the initial current or the net current, whatever you call it. And we also know something. We know that the potential drop across this resistors is the same. And using that, can't we calculate the net resistance? So I can just, you know, basically substitute, you know, V by R net. So let's call that imaginary resistor as R net. V by R net is equal to, like, you know, V by R1 plus V by R2 plus V by R3. Okay, because V is equal to I1 R1 is equal to I2 R2 is equal to I3 R3. Can't we say that, you know, like, you know, V by R net is equal to V by R1 plus V by R2 plus V by R3. Then what is the net resistance being in this, in that case? The what, the inverse of net resistance is equal to the sum of inverses of each of these resistors connected in parallel. Okay. So 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. And what would be the ratio of current flowing through them? Inverse of resistance. You already know the value of I1, which is nothing but V by R1, because you know that the potential dropping across R1 is going to be V by V. Okay. Similarly, across R2 it's going to be V. Across R3 it's going to be V. And in that case, you also know the current across the resistor R1, the current is going to be V by R1, and across R2 it is going to be V by R2, and across R3 it is going to be V by R3. Okay, and then, you know, the ratio of current is going to be inversely proportional to the resistance. So larger the value of resistance of a resistor, that means lesser current is going to flow through it if it is placed in a parallel combination. Smaller the value of resistance of the resistor placed in a parallel combination would have the most current flowing through. This is also logical, isn't it? Think of it. You are this current, or I am the current, and you are trying to enter the node. Okay, you would try to take the path that has the least resistance. So the most current will be trying to flow through the path that has the least resistance. Let's say in this case R2 has the least resistance. So most of the current, or like, you know, like maximum or the highest amount of current would flow through R2. Okay, even if you take n such resistance in parallel combination, just in parallel combination, we know that 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3 plus 1 by R4, so on till 1 by Rn. You can use the same relation. Even you can work it out and find it out. There is not going to be any difference because you have to ultimately, you know, add these currents to make the I, the final current and the initial current I. And what about the ratio of currents? They are to, you know, going to be inversely proportional to R, or the value of resistance. So I1 is to I2 is to I3 is to I4 is to so on till IN is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R1 is to 1 by R2 is to 1 by R3, so on till 1 by R. And this thing is also pretty intuitive, like pretty, you know, logical and intuitive. And similarly, in the case of, you know, series combination, you knew that the most voltage drop or the highest voltage drop is going to be across the resistor with highest resistance because the same current is flowing through. Okay. Now let's do something, you know, we'll have some, you know, handy expressions so that if you are getting some, you know, equations related to parallel combinations or some problem related to parallel combinations, you can just make use of those handy relations. But anyway, sometimes, you know, 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3 is going to be sometimes easier. First, let's work it out for, you know, three resistors in parallel combination. Let's say R1, R2, R3 are in parallel combination. Then in that case, 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. Okay. In that case, 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. We just saw how we derived it just earlier, just adding the currents. And in that case, can I just, you know, add all of these terms? And what would I get on the numerator and on the denominator? On the denominator, it would be 1 by R net is equal to R1, R2, R3 on the denominator. Whereas on the numerator, I would get R1, R2 plus R1, R3 plus R2, R3. Okay. Similarly, when if you do it for n resistances, you can work out the same way. For an example, let's say we have four resistors in parallel combination. Okay. Let's say this value of the resistors are like R1, R2, R3, R4. In that case, what would be 1 by R net? 1 by R net would be 1 by the inverse of the net resistance would be R1, R2, R3, R1 into R1, R2 plus R3 plus of R2 into R3 into R4 plus of R3 into R4 into R1. And you'll also find out the fourth expression, that is that unique expression that involves only three terms, divided by R1, R2, R3, like multiplication product of R1, R2, R3 and R4. Okay. So last one would be like R3, R4, R3, like, you know, something like that. R3, R3, R4. You can work it out on the paper. And even if you take for n resistances, you can use the same trick. Where you are saying, you know, the first one is going to be R1 into R2 into R3 into, you know, 1 by R net is equal to R1 into R2 into, so until, you know, Rn minus 1 or something like that. And similarly, you'll rotate it in a cyclic way. And you'll finally find, you need to take those unique, you know, n terms. And you'll get the value. If you take the inverse, you'll get the value of net resistance. So net resistance can be written as, you know, in case of three resistors, R1 into R2 into R3 divided by R1 R2 plus R2 R3 plus R3 R1. Even if you work it out for two resistors in parallel, we can just ignore the third term in this case. That would nothing be inverse of this quantity, which is going to be R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. Okay, students, very easy. So how do you really identify whether, you know, a given confusing circuit or, you know, like a very complex circuit is whether, you know, these resistors are in parallel or series combination? We can make use of few techniques. One technique is what we talked before. If you see two resistors and if they have, you know, only one common node, but rest are not, you know, common, like, you know, two nodes are not common, probably they are in series connection. And if they have two common nodes, then they are definitely in parallel connection. Okay, if the resistors connected in parallel should have two common nodes or two common connections or ends on the both end. And the other way would be drawing the current. Okay, if you draw the current from the potential source, or let's say if you draw current towards that node, if these currents get divided, then they are in parallel combination. And if these currents flow through those network of resistors, that means these resistors are in series combination. And one of the most robust ways would be to draw the current to understand whether these resistors are in series or parallel combination, rather than, you know, thinking about nodes, which may be little time consuming. But just, you know, draw a current into that node and understand how this current is flowing. If this current is, you know, getting divided, that means they are in parallel combination. If the current is just being the same, there is no way for that current to divide. There is no node at that point, like, you know, more than two combination of circuits connected over there. That means it's a series connection. So let's do some problems, students. Like, you know, this was a very interesting concept. We will revise it again, even in the next, you know, lecture a little bit. But let's do some problems, and also we'll see some strategies going forward in this lecture. Okay, until now, what we have to, if you're already, you know, well versed with this topic, this is something very easy for you. Until now, whatever I have told is something, you know, that you either remember or you already know it. But what if there is, you know, like a very complex circuit or something like that? We have so many techniques in this kind of, like, you know, combination of resistors to solve. So many techniques, not just one, two. To name a few, there is delta star, you know, like symmetry methods, and also equipotential methods. But today we'll be covering, you know, those few techniques which will be, you know, very much useful in solving given, you know, specific questions without any Wheatstone bridge, etc. We'll be covering Wheatstone bridges and everything in the coming lectures. But now we'll also have a look at some interesting problems as we move forward. I know this is a very easy problem for you guys, so come on, keep answering such problems. This is one of those easiest problems. So here is given a circuit, and there is, you know, a bunch of resistors connected across A and B. They are asking you to find the resistance between A and B, or the net resistance between A and B. Do you want to go by drawing the current, or you can just do it, you know, just, you know, like intuitively how you have done it before or through your practice. Now if you see this current, if I take a current from A, it will flow through 4 ohms. Then it will get divided at this place. Okay. And then they will join back over here. That means this 1 and 2 ohm are in parallel. You can directly make use of R1, R2 by R1 plus R2. Students, you should be answering these kind of questions as well. I know this is just the beginning. For many of you, this is just the beginning. But you need to, you know, even tune yourself to solve numerical problems involving some numbers. So this the value of this parallel combination would be somewhere like, you know, 1 into 2 by 1 plus 2, that's going to be 2 by 3. And these parallel combination and these 4 ohm and 3 ohm are in series connection. If you see that, the current flowing through this 4 ohm flows through this parallel combination and also flows through the 3 ohms. So what should be the total value of resistance or the net resistance? So 4 plus 3 plus 2 by 3, which is nothing but 7 plus 2 by 3. 7 plus 2 by 3 means 21 plus 2 by 3 is 23 by 3. 23 by 3 ohms is the net resistance between A and B. I know this question is very simple. Most of you must have got this correct. There's no way you're getting it wrong. Very interesting question, guys. Very, very interesting, very practical question. So what is being asked over here? The best way to connect heavy electrical equipments like lights and fans is in series, parallel, or combination of series and parallel. What would be the best way to connect heavy electrical equipments, or even, let's say, you know, not that heavy electrical equipments? What do you think would be the best way to connect? Guys, come on, this should be something that you should have understood from the concept of, you know, parallel and series. What is happening in parallel and what is happening in series? You need to carefully look at how these charges or current was flowing. That will give you the answer to this problem. See, let's say I'm connecting all my electrical equipments in series. Let's start from there. then what would happen? Then in that case, let's say the current flows and this bulb suddenly blows off. This bulb suddenly blows off. Then what would happen? The current that was flowing from ear to ear could not anymore flow. It would become an open circuit. So your entire home will go dim. Okay. Even if one bulb flows off when everything is connected in series, what would happen is your entire home would go dim. Let's say in case of parallel combination, the second bulb went off. Still, don't you think both this electrical equipment should be functional? Okay. That means the best way to connect them is in parallel. There may be like, you know, additional requirements that could be, you know, needed. But the best way to connect the electrical equipments are in parallel. Which at least lets the other devices to function when one device is out of order due to some, you know, like something like, you know, that it went short, or even if it went short, it's a very risky thing. If you connect things in like, you know, series or parallel, actually in that case, actually parallel becomes more dangerous. It's weird actually. If you think about it, if all this, you know, the best way to connect that way should be also parallel. According to the question, series. But anyway, if you think about it carefully, let's say I'm connecting electrical equipments in parallel combination and one of them got short. Generally it does not happen, it's a manufacturing fault. That's why the answer is series in this case. But do remember, the answer to this question is series. But if in that case one of the devices goes short, the best way would be series. Because in parallel, what would happen? The resistance is becoming zero. That means too much current will flow through that particular combination. Rest of the parts would not find anything. It would be a weird case. But anyway, generally speaking, you're expecting the device to become, you know, to blow off and to become open circuit, or the device to go out of order and not function. So parallel is the best way to connect these electrical equipment. Parallel is the best way to connect the answer for this question is parallel. And do remember this, guys, the answer for this question is parallel. Earlier I said that it might be series, but the answer for this question is parallel. Okay, so it's a confusingly challenged problem. The equivalent resistance of an X combination of resistors is found to be always greater than the largest resistance in the combination X. Then the combination X is series, parallel, both series and parallel, neither series nor parallel. So there is such combination X, and you connected all this resistors in this combination X, okay, and you found that, you know, the net resistance, the equivalent resistance of the combination, is always greater than the largest resistance or the largest resistor in the combination. Then what should be the combination? This is like, you know, like a universal fact. It should be series. Okay. It should be series. So what would happen in that case? If I'm connecting all these resistors in series, then I know the net resistance is going to be R1 plus R2 plus R3 plus R4, so on. Let's say R4 is the largest resistor among them. In that case, you know, all this rest of the values can be smaller than R4, but they are positive. No way they are negative. That means R net is always going to be larger than R4, which means it is that series combination where the net resistance or the equivalent resistance of the combination is always greater than the largest resistance in the combination. It's like an universal truth, you can call it anything. Now let's get to the confuse me challenge problem 2. This is a very interesting problem. I think we spoke about this concept earlier, but anyway, guys, start answering these kind of questions. So the question says, the equivalent resistance of an X combination of resistor, the equivalent resistance of an X combination of resistor is found to be always smaller than the smallest resistance in the combination X. Then the combination X is. So what is happening is, you have created this time another combination X. and you found that this equivalent resistance is always even smaller than the smallest resistance in the combination, then what should be that kind of combination? Guys, come on, you should be commenting now. You should be answering these kind of questions. It's a very conceptual question, and these kind of questions can be even asked in your rest of the competitive exams. It may not be necessarily in IIT JEE. In IIT JEE, you may have some hints around these kind of concepts. Okay, I'll in fact show you some problem, you know, like where we are solving this problem, not really an IIT JEE problem. We are also solving an IIT JEE problem, but in that, you know, like problem, you'll see there is a hint around this kind of concept. So what should be the answer, guys? Like, try to answer this question. Be quick. There is nothing you have to think in this. Don't you think parallel should be the answer? If you connect resistors in parallel, the net resistance should be always smaller than the smallest resistance. Because if you remember, 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3, so on till 1 by Rn for a parallel combination. In that case, let's say R3 is the smallest resistance, or you know, like then 1 by R3 is going to have the largest value. Okay. In this case, 1 by R net is greater than any of the resistor, be it the smallest resistor or the, you know, largest resistor. If you take the inverse of 1 by R net, it's going to be R net, which is going to be smaller than even the smallest resistor. Doesn't it? Isn't it like, again, like an universal truth of the series and parallel combination topic? So let's say 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3, so on till plus 1 by Rn. And now let's take R3 is the smallest resistor. We know 1 by R net is greater than 1 by, you know, R3. Because R3 is anyway the smallest resistor, but still 1 by R net has, you know, like other 1 by R1, 1 by R2, other positive values added to it. That means 1 by R net is like greater than 1 by R3, always and ever, okay, in a parallel combination. If I take the inverse of it, then I know that, or then I come to know that the net resistance in a parallel combination is smaller than even the smallest resistance in that combination of resistors. Okay, this is also kind of intuitive, I know. Like, you know, when we are talking about those problems where whether you should connect in series or parallel, you knew it was parallel, but you also sort of knew that reason why it was parallel. The net load is also going to be a little lesser compared to, you know, if you connect it on an individual load. Alright students, now let's get to the confuse me challenge problem number 3. The equivalent conductance of X combination of resistor is found to be always smaller than the smallest conductance of any individual resistor in the combination X. Then the combination should be, whether A it is series, B it is parallel, C it is both series and parallel, D neither series nor parallel. So the question is saying, you have taken the equivalent conductance or the net conductance of a combination X. Okay, this time again another combination X. And now when you are assessing this conductance, you are finding that this conductance is always smaller than the smallest conductance of any individual. I mean the conductance of any individual resistor. Okay. Then what should be this combination X? Come on students, quickly, try to answer it, you know, try to comment on the comment box. If you're on live chat, try to, you know, answer this kind of questions. It's pretty intuitive. I mean, all you need to think is about those expressions. What is the expression for, you know, series combination and parallel combination? Don't you think it would be series? I'm talking about conductance over here. So conductance should have an inverse property. Anyway, equivalent resistance of, you know, a combination X, you know, like for a series combination, the equivalent resistance is going to be the largest. That means, shouldn't the equivalent conductance be the smallest? Anyway, it is larger than any value over there. That means it is going to be, inverse of it is going to be smaller than any inverse of the smaller value over there. Okay, and we'll work it out a little bit to understand what is going on. So you know this thing, R net is equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3 in a series combination. Let's say R4 is the largest resistor. That means it should have the lowest conductance. Larger resistance means lesser conductance. Okay. Now, if I add this R1, R2, R3, R4, that means it is the net resistance. It is always greater than R4. Okay. Now, you take an inverse. This relation will become opposite. Like this over here. That means, can't I write this as net resistance? 1 by R1 plus R2 plus R3 plus R4, so on till Rn will be net resistance. R4 is the one that resistor that has the smallest conductance or the lowest conductance. That means I can also write that 1 by R net in series is less than 1 by R4. If I take the conductance of resistor R4 as G4 and the net conductance and the equivalent conductance of the combination G net as G net, then G net is equal to 1 by R. Then I can say that G net is always going to be lesser than G4. Even the smallest conductance, one resistor that has the highest resistor or the smallest conductance. Okay, now I guess next problem should be a cakewalk for you. And you should be probably knowing the answer by now and you should be answering even now. So equivalent conductance of X combination is found to be always greater than the greatest conductance of any individual resistor in combination X. Then the combination X is, so the question says, you have taken a combination, you found the, you know, like the equivalent conductance of the combination, and you are seeing that this equivalent conductance is always going to be greater than conductance of any individual resistor. Then what should be this combination? Whether it should be series, parallel, both series and parallel, or neither series nor parallel. There again it becomes a universal truth. So the thing should be parallel. You remember 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3, so on till 1 by Rn. Let's say, you know, here which one is going to have the least, highest conductance? Which individual resistor is going to have the highest conductance? The one that has the least value of resistance. Let's say in this case it is R3. So this R3, 1 by R net is always greater than 1 by R3. Okay, 1 by R net is nothing but equivalent conductance of the combination, of the parallel, you know, combination of resistors. That means equivalent conductance in this case is always greater than any individual conductance or conductance of any individual resistor. So this is like, you know, 1 by R net is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3, so on. Now, let's say that, you know, I'm taking R3 as the smallest resistor, which must have the highest conductance. In that case, 1 by R net is greater than 1 by R3. Okay? Because there are rest of the terms are positive. 1 by R1, 1 by R2, 1 by R3, these, 1 by R4, these all are positive. And let's say conductance of R3 is nothing but G3, which is going to be 1 by R3. Inverse relation, and G net is equal to 1 by R net. Okay, equivalent conductance, which is nothing but inverse of equivalent resistance. Then in that case, we know that if this is true, then this is also true, because 1 by R net is nothing but G net, 1 by R3 is nothing but G3. So the net conductance of this parallel combination is going to be always greater than. This is wrong, guys. What is written over here is wrong. So this should be this way. So 1 by, like G net, like the net conductance is always greater than conductance of any individual resistor. Okay, easy. Now let's do this problem. It's a challenge problem. and actually it's a very easy problem. Guys, come on, try answering this kind of problems. This really really easy. If you carefully look at it, it's really 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 very easy problem. Even you know the numbers are given in such a way. I try to make sure you know I take numbers in at least in this like you know lecture sessions simple so that you understand the concept. But you should be practicing with somewhat complex numbers given you have some time. Once you have completed the concepts, you have to work around with little bit of complicated numbers so that these things become really easy for you. With an exam, sometimes you never know, like you may get little complicated numbers or complicated calculations. Then it becomes really once you practice, you become perfect and it becomes really easy to do it that way. So you have to find the resistance between A and B. Okay. Now, how do I know whether these resistors are in parallel or series? I draw a current. Now the current should get divided at this spot. Okay, at this spot the current should get divided. But these two resistors are in series, and these two resistors are in series, and this combination are in parallel. What is the value of this series combination? 20 ohms. And this series combination, it is 30 ohms. This 20 ohms and 30 ohms are in parallel because you are talking between A and B. This is where the current got divided and this is where the current will add up between these two resistors. So what is the net resistance in this case? 1 by R net is equal to 1 by 20 plus 1 by 30. 1 by 20 plus 1 by 30 is equal to the common LCM would be 60. Okay, you need not resort to LCM to calculate this, but anyway, then LCM would be 60. And what would be on the numerator? 3 and 5, you have to multiply 20 by 3 to get to 60, whereas you have to multiply 30 by 2 to get to 60. So it's 3 plus 2 by 60. That is nothing by 5 by 60, that is 1 by R net, which is nothing but 1 by R net is equal to 5 by 60 means 1 by 12. So R net should be 12 ohms. Yeah. R net should be 12 ohms. Now, let me tell you an interesting way of looking at this problem. Let's say you are just given this options A, B, and C. Okay. A is 60 ohms, B is 30 ohms, C is 12 ohms, D is 24 ohms. Okay. A is 60 ohms, B is 30 ohms, C is 12 ohms, D is 24 ohms. You know the value of net resistance over here? It's 20 ohms. The value of net resistance over here? It is 30 ohms. Among these options, which one is lesser than 20, the smallest resistance in parallel combination? Only C. Easy. Sometimes which is the choice between which you have to guess. We make use of these kind of facts. Pretty easy. Easier than what we did before, taking 1 by 20 plus 1 by 30. Maybe you want to use these tricks, but in a limit, you need to make sure you're not messing up with the problem. Let's say there is like a 15 ohms and 12 ohms, then things can go wrong. But this was a very simple problem, I guess. I guess most of you must have got this problem correct, and it's an easy problem for you guys. So now let's come to this problem. Challenge problem number 4. Now again, find the resistance between A and B. Okay. And if you draw the current, you'll come to know this 8 ohm, and these combination of resistances are in parallel. This 8 ohm and the combination over here, this combination over here above is in parallel. And again, these resistors are in parallel. Again, these resistors are in parallel. Okay, and these combination of resistances are in series. Okay. Now let's say this problem is easy. Maybe you got different kind of like an architecture or a different kind of design in this resistor problems. Then what would you do, or is there any strategy to make sure you crack these kind of problems very easily without putting any efforts. This is an easy problem. Let's say it's like this. We'll do such kind of problems, you know, like where the resistances are mixed and matched. Now, how do you make sure you solve such problems? So there is a strategy to attack such kind of problems. See, one you know is you have to draw the path of current from the initial point to the final point. Let's say in that case it was A, then till the final point B, for identifying whether the resistances are in series or parallel combination. Whether the resistances in the path are in series or parallel combination. And now in this path, you have to find all the possible series resistances that can be solved without the interruption or intervention of parallel, you know, parallel formulas, because parallel formulas are a little more complicated. Series is easier. You just add and go. So solve for all possible series combination resistances that are not in parallel or that are not, you know, getting deviated. You should be careful. You should draw the current to make sure that resistor is not in parallel combination with other resistors. I mean, individually they can be, you know, in series and not be in parallel with anything. That is fine. But, you know, it should not look like, you know, this is in this both parallel, these two resistors are in parallel combination again with series. Then you should not add it. Then you should make sure you are just doing for it for the series one. And now, if you cannot proceed with, you know, adding up for series, then what you do is you solve for the parallel. All the parallel resistances, until you get to a point where you have bunch of series resistances. Then you again add the series resistances. And if any parallel, you would repeat it. So you'd repeat those two, step number two and step number three. Like this is what we are doing, right? Like this is what we are doing. First, initially we added this, you know, series combination. Even in this problem or in this problem, we added, you know, the series combination. We added the series combination. Then it was not possible anymore to solve using, you know, just add and move. So what we did the parallel combination. In this case we got the answer. Maybe in other cases you solve the parallel combination and again there is a series you have to solve. Yeah, and repeat this, and then there you go, boom, you got the equivalent resistance. So initially draw the path of the current to find out which resistances are in parallel or series. And then what you do is you will find the possible series resistances that you can solve first. And then what you do is you solve all of the series resistances that can be solved. And then what you do is you will find those parallel combinations which you have to solve to get to again series problem. You solve the series problem, the circuit becomes smaller and smaller, and then you get back and again solve the parallel problems, and then again you solve the series problem, and maybe you want to iterate it twice or thrice, and then you would get the answer. There are easier methods than this. We'll explore that, but they are only applicable for, you know, like special cases. They're not always applicable. But this is always applicable. If you know that, you know, except for the equipotential, if you find any equipotential thing, then you would have to remove the resistor. We'll talk about it. But this is like, you know, you can, this is a strategy that you can apply uniformly to solve any problem. Okay, sounds easy. Now let's solve this problem using that technique, you know. I don't want to anymore, you know, spend too much energy. I want a systematic method to do it, easier method to do it. Maybe, you know, I don't want to, you know, get tense during the exam. I mean, my motto is not to get stressed during the exam. Better we perform. Okay. So first thing that looks, you know, pretty weird to me is this 10 and 15 ohms. I can solve that. 1 by 10 plus 1 by 15, 1 by 30. That's 3 plus 2, 5, 5 by 30 is nothing but 1 by 6, 1 by Rnet is 6 means, 1 by 6 means Rnet is 6 ohms. Now, next one would be this, because in this case I am not able to get into series combination directly. So first I will have to solve all the parallel problems to get into the series thing. So it would be 1 by 24 plus 1 by 12 plus 1 by 24 is equal to Rnet 2. Okay, Rnet 1 is solved over here. 1 by Rnet is equal to 1 by 10 plus 1 by 15, 5 by 30. This is the 1 by 6. So coming to the second parallel combination, that would be 1 by 24 plus 1 by 12 plus 1 by 24. That would be nothing but 4 by 24. 1 by 24 plus 1 by 24. plus 1 by 12. That is 2 by 24. So that would be 4 by 24. 4 by 24 is 1 by Rnet 2. And the Rnet would be 6 ohms again. Okay. 6 ohms again. Now, this 6 ohms, this 6 ohms, and this 12 ohms are in series. Okay, this series problem I can solve before getting into any parallel problem. This is the first thing I need to do to solve this problem. I mean, the next thing. But now to solve the problem, this is the first thing I need to do. That would be 24 ohms, 12 plus 12. That is 6 plus 6, right? So it would be 24 ohms. The total resistance would be 24 ohms. Now this 24 ohms and 8 ohms are in parallel combination. That means, what is the total net resistance? 1 by 24 by plus 1 by 8 is equal to 1 by R equivalent. That would be 3 by 24 plus 1 by 24, which is nothing but 4 by 24. That is going to be 6 ohms, I guess. Okay. Yeah. This 24 and this 8 are in parallel, which is going to be 4 by 24, 6 ohms. So the answer is 6 ohms. But again, if you carefully notice the options, you already know the answer. Because 6 ohms is really that value which is lesser than 8 ohms. 8 ohms is equivalent to 8 ohms, but already you have a 24 ohms over there. That means it should be less than 8 ohms. And what about 12 and 24 ohms? They are also greater than the value. But you may not get always questions like this. If you get it in some competitive exams, you can, you know, quickly assess it and mark it, just mark it. It will save you a lot of time. I generally say, you know, for kinematics and all, you know, just don't go with formulas or don't go with facts or something like that. But in some cases, you can make use of it to kill the problem faster. It's about timing also, right? Like, it's not just about knowing the concepts and everything. Because here you are for also exams. So you need to make sure, sometimes you make use of this tiny mini dirty tricks too. Quickly, this is not a dirty trick, it's a universal fact. But anyway, finding out from the option is not the best thing to do. But it is one of those strategies. Guys, we'll be discussing this in the special class. So it is one of those strategies where you'll be making use of method of substitution, method of elimination to solve problems. Even you can do that in, you know, chemistry and chemistry to some extent and mathematics. Again, a very interesting problem. Looks like a JE mains problem. Now, this is a weird resistance. Like, with this is like, you know, bunch of resistance. But actually, there is a very easy way to do this. We'll discuss this in coming lecture. In this lecture, we'll make use of the traditional way, you know, the way that we did it now to solve the problem. So if you draw the, you know, the path of current, you'll come to know these two are in parallel. These two are in parallel. These two are in parallel. These two are in parallel, and of course these two are in parallel. Okay, so current will go from here. This is the resistor that you may not be considering now, because there is no way to take up, you know, the like the series addition. Now what you are seeing is this node, once it comes to this node, it's the same node. Okay. Now the current gets divided in two paths. One path is this, one path is this. And similarly over here, again it gets divided into two paths. And it goes over here and again it gets divided into two paths. This is also in parallel. Again it comes out, gets added, again it gets divided into two paths. Okay. And same way it will come over here, it will get divided into two paths and it will come over there. Now guys, do remember one thing. Okay, this is a short trick that I am going to tell you, because I might have noticed some question. So if you come across any problem, okay, this is the problem that we are doing. Okay, let's say I connect just a wire over here. What would happen? What would be the net resistance? I've shorted the circuit. You're not worried about rest of the resistances. These two potentials are equal actually. If you see it that way. But when you are solving for resistance problems, you do it this way. Find out which is in parallel, which is in parallel. You solve for this parallel. First, you will try to eliminate the series. Add the series. Try to make the circuit look smaller. And then you would go for the, you know, parallel attack. Solving for the parallel problems, parallel resistors that are in parallel combination. Okay, easy. So in this case, what would be the resistance? Guys, any answers, any guesses? It's easy. If you already know some tricks around this, you know, symmetry, you can do this problem very easily. Okay, this all resistances have a value R. Each resistance in the circuit has a value R. Find the equivalent resistance between A and B. Okay, students, so how do we do that? So now, as usual, I'm going to find out which are in parallel, because now I don't have an opportunity to solve a series. I'll go for parallel and solve them. So this is R. If each of these resistances are R, that means this combination is R by 2. And similarly, if this is like, you know, R and R, this combination is R by 2. Similarly, over here, this combination is R and R means this is R by 2. And if this combination is R and R means this is R by 2. So that way you'll get these combinations as R by 2, R by 2, R by 2, R by 2. And in fact, this would also be R by 2. And this also would be R by 2. Okay. Now you got these answers. Now again, these are in parallel. Okay. Now if you carefully look at it. Okay. So this is R by 2, R by 2, R by 2, R by 2. Now these are in parallel. So you're not going to go for this. You're going to find the series one first. R2 plus R2 plus R2. That would be 3R2 by 2. So this node, it becomes parallel from A, if you carefully notice it. From this node, it becomes parallel. Whereas, if you notice it, you know, like from this node, you see that this is a parallel, this is a parallel, these two are parallel. But whereas these are in series, this combination, and this combination is in series. So that would be sum of all the resistances, which is nothing but 3R by 2. Okay, for the top one, it's going to be 3R by 2. For the bottom one, it's going to be 3R by 2. Okay, easy, awesome. Now this would be 3R by 2, very easy. Now it sounds very easy. Now these 3R by 2, how they are connected? Okay, how are they connected? Let's see that. Now let's what should we do is we should highlight the things. So you see this resistor over here. This is a value R. Again the resistor over here has a value R. But these have, like, you know, two paths through which you can reach this node or this, you know, end of the connection of R and R. That would be 1 3R by 2 3R by 2. So you would initially solve for this parallel combination, and this, the value of this parallel combination 3R by 2 3R by 2 would be 3R into 3R by 2 3R by 2 into 3R by 2 divided by 3R by 4 plus 3R by 4. If 3R by 2, okay, this it's written over here. So that would be basically 3R by 4. So that would be 1 by R net is equal to 2 by 3R plus 2 by 3R. That would be nothing but 4R by 3. So R net would be 3R by 4, simply. Now this 3R by 4, R and R are in combination, series combination. That means this 3R by 4, this initial R, which was just, you know, attached to A, and but rather, you know, if it is on this side, on that place it would have been in this side. Okay, it's shown on the opposite side in the equivalent diagram, but you know, you understood it very well. Like this is that R. I'll show you which is that R. I'll say this is that R. In this case, this is that R, that near point F. Okay, similarly, the other R near B is nothing but this one. But these are in series. So you can basically add them. R plus 3R by 4 plus R. That would yield 11R by 4. So net resistance or the equivalent resistance is 11R/4. Now comes the real confusion. So from this option, you cannot work the old trick. So 10R/4R you would eliminate it directly. Okay, once you saw 3R/4. But what about 11R/3 and 11R/4? You have to work on the problem. Quite easy. Again, a very interesting problem. Find the equivalent resistance between A and B. So where is A? A is somewhere over here. B is somewhere over here. Okay. Now you need to find how to find the resistance between A and B. I mean, like, first of all, you need to find the resistance between A and B. I know you guys can do it. You need to find the resistance between A and B. So this is again, you're going to make use of the same strategy. That is it. Guys, try to answer this question. Right away, you should be answering such questions. It's a very, very easy question. I mean, in fact, while you're drawing on your notebook, you can directly draw the equivalent resistance. So this is one of the tricks that you need to follow while doing a JEE exam. You know what? Or any competitive exam. While drawing the circuit, don't start from the beginning. If you have already calculated that, you know, resistance, you know, equivalent resistance, just go along with them. Don't waste time, you know, like on, and do notice if there is a Wheatstone bridge or, you know, like some other, you know, EQ potential points and things like that. But directly write down the equivalent resistance while you're drawing it. So it becomes very fast. Very fast means very, very fast. Because you don't have to draw it again, really simple, no other reason. But anyway, so now let's work on this problem. Any guesses, guys? Any guesses on the answers? Any guesses if you're watching, you know, like, you know, live, or if you're watching as a recorded one? Guys, do comment with the answers. It's a very, very easy problem. It is normal series combination problem, that is it. It is. This is one of the tricks used in even JEE. They'll give you the problem in, you know, different shapes and it looks weird. But if you see, it has nothing in it. Like, it does basic problems when you are trying to solve them. We'll see some problems as we move along. Maybe in advance there are little bit, you know, problems that may look little complicated, but you can solve them. You need to, all you need to do is be, you know, attend some lectures, be regular, also give some test series. Keep practicing and keep practicing and keep practicing. Things become easier. So now let's solve for A and B. Okay, I'm not erasing A and B. So this is in series combination. This is the current is flowing from here. This is in series combination. This is in parallel. This is in parallel. So the thing that I was talking about earlier, like I told you, you know, there might appear some place where it is in series, but it's actually not in series. You'll have to solve a bunch of parallel to come to that series. That is this 3-ohm. Okay, so if you see this, this both are in series combination, but whereas rest of the nodes are in parallel combination. Okay, even until here. So you solve this problem step by step, it will become very easy. So this was 3 and 3, that would give me 6 ohms since they are in series. Now this 6 ohms and this 6 ohms are in parallel combination. This is where the current got divided, right? So 6 ohms and 6 ohms are in parallel combination. Which means that would yield 3 ohms, 6/2, R into R by R plus R. So that would be, yeah, 3 ohms. So this would be 3 ohms and this is 3 ohms. That means that would be total of 6 ohms. Okay, guys. Again, I mean, this 3 ohms and this 3 ohms is going to be total of 6 ohms. You know, we took the parallel output or parallel, you know, equivalent at this moment, that was 3 ohms, and this 3 ohm, which is nothing but in series combination. Now it is in series combination. Earlier it wasn't, now it is in series combination. So that would be 3 plus 3, another 6 ohms. Okay, and this is 6, you know, already this is 6 ohms and this is 6 ohms. So this entire of circle would be 3 ohms. Easy? Pretty awesome. Now, this 3 ohms, if you just substitute this entire thing by one resistor, isn't it in series with this 3 ohms? that would give me 6 ohms again. So this entire thing was 3 ohms. This entire thing was 3 ohms. Then put as an equivalent resistor would be in series with this 3 ohms. And that entire thing would be 6 ohms. Okay students, easy? Now this 6 ohms, if you write just one resistor instead of this 3 ohms, you erase this 3 ohms and write it as 6 ohms. And you see that this 6 ohms, this 6 ohms and this 6 ohms actually are not in parallel. This 6 ohm and this 6 ohm is in parallel, and this 3 ohm would be in series with this parallel combination, because this 3 ohm is connected between A and B. Okay, so this 6 ohms and this 6 ohms would be in parallel, and that would give me another 3 ohms for this entire, you know, like circuit until here. Again you substitute with another resistor and you would find that this 3 ohms and this 3 ohms are in series. That is another 6 ohms. Between A and B now there is a 6 ohms and another 3 ohms, which means the total net resistance would be 1 by R net is equal to 1 by 6 plus 1 by 3, which is going to be 2 by 6 plus that would be like 2 ohms. 1 by 6 plus 1 by 3, but here the answer is given in terms of 11 R. I guess the options are wrong, guys. So it should be 2 ohms, okay? The options haven't been corrected yet. So guys, do notice the options given over here. It is not corrected yet. It's 10 ohms, 11 ohms. I think it got copied from the last problem. So it should be 2. You understood the technique. You understood the entire technique, I guess. So that is not that options are not correct. That should be like 2 ohms. Okay. Understood, right? Like here, until here it was like 6 ohms. This entire thing, when you saw this entire circle. And this entire circle was in parallel combination with 3 ohms. 6 ohms with parallel with, you know, 3 ohms, that would be 1 by 6 plus 1 by 3 is equal to R net, where R net would become be equal to 2 ohms. 3 by 6, 1 by R net. So 2 ohms total. Now let's solve. This is a very, very interesting problem, students. If you understand this problem, it's going to be like, you know, everything around this resistor problems may be easy. Actually, it's a special kind of problem. It's an infinite resistor combination problem. So why do we call it infinite resistance? Because there are infinite such combinations. Like this would keep repeating. This pattern would just keep repeating. If you carefully notice this would keep repeating, and it is in fact it will be given in the question that this pattern will keep repeating. So all dotted lines have this pattern. Okay. So how do we solve these kind of problems? You need to find one repeating unit. Okay. In this case, R and R are the repeating unit. And then again, this R and R repeating unit. This is also a repeating unit. This is also a repeating unit. Okay. So one repeating unit, and you'd assume the rest repeating unit as the equivalent. What I mean to say is, to calculate the equivalent, I would do some math. In this case, not really physics, I would do some math. Like mathematical assumptions. So now, I would take this entire, you know, repeating units as an R equivalent. You know, the resistance of this infinite combination. Infinite resistor combination. Then it would become really easy, won't it? Then can't I say like, you know, can't I say this? Because these two resistors are not going to change anything much. Think about it. So let's say I've just omitted one like combination in between. It's not going to make big difference. It's going to make a difference, but not that big a difference. And when it comes to infinite, it's not going to make any difference. So I can rather substitute this entire repeating units over here. This entire repeating units over here with just an R infinite. And now say this, you know, the equivalent resistance of this circuit is nothing but R infinite, because there are infinite repeating units. I know if you are very new to this topic, you are probably thinking, how is this possible? But think about it, infinite resistors will appear as if, you know, there is not much change when you are, you know, like omitting two units. In this case, you have omitted these two units. So that would not make much change. Okay, easy. Now this R infinite is actually in parallel with this R. To solve this circuit, first we need to know which is in parallel, which is in series. Whether we can go with series, no. Now first, which is in parallel, these two are in parallel, R infinite and the R, that unit, repeating unit of the resistor of the repeating unit. And these both are in series with this R. Okay. These both are in series with this R. Okay. R infinite is parallel to R, this R, and this is in series with this R, which is nothing but R infinite. Okay. Now, can't I write this? R infinite into R divided by R infinite plus R plus of R is equal to R infinite. This is the expression for parallel combination. R infinite and R are in parallel combination. And this is the expression for, this entire thing is the expression for adding this parallel combination with this series resistor R. And this is saying that you know, I've just left these two repeating units, that is not going to change the problem much. I mean the value much. Now, if I take this R on the other side, that would be R infinite minus R, and there is an R infinite plus R on the denominator. Can't I just multiply them both? Can't I write it like this? I took this R over here, R infinite minus R, and I multiplied it with R infinite plus R. So that would give me R infinite into R is equal to R infinite minus R into R infinite plus R. R infinite minus R into R infinite plus R is in A minus B into A plus B combination. This is nothing but A square minus B square, which is going to give you R infinite square minus of R square, and you take this R infinite R on the other side as well. Okay. And then you would get R infinite square minus R infinite R is equal to 0. Okay. Now what is this? This is a quadratic equation where R infinite is the unknown and R is the known. This is a quadratic equation where R is known and R infinite is unknown. Now, to find out the root of R infinite, can't I make use of that, you know, minus B plus or minus under root of B square minus 4AC divided by 2A. Can I make use of the formula? Of course I can. And what is the B over here? Minus R. So minus of minus B plus R under root of minus R squared, because in this case B squared is again minus R. Okay, this should not be there. So in this case B squared is minus R again. So that would be R squared minus 4AC. A is 1, C is minus R square again, and minus 4AC would become plus, and there would be 2 on the bottom because A is 1. Okay. Now let's do a thing. Let's find out the roots. We already found out the roots, which is going to be R minus of minus R, R squared minus minus of R square, minus 4 into minus R square, which is going to be plus 4, which is going to give you, if I take out this R squared as common, or even if I compute it, I mean like I calculate it, and if I just leave it, then I would get that R into root 5. Okay, but the roots would come in terms of R plus or minus R into root 5 plus by 2. Okay, the R infinite combination that we found out through, you know, like solving this quadratic equation, we got R infinite is equal to r plus or minus r under root 5 by 2. So whether it should be plus or minus? It can't be minus. If it is minus, then r infinite would become negative. If it is minus, r infinite would become negative. It should be plus. So it would be r into, so this would be the final one, r plus r root 5 by 2, this entire expression by 2, and you take out the r common, not necessarily, you can leave it over here, but anyway, solve the problem. So r infinite is equal to r into 1 plus under root 5 by 2. Okay, this is the way you approach any infinite resistor combination problems. Given an infinite resistor combination problem, you will assume that this repeating unit, you will skip one of the repeating unit, and you will assume that equivalent of these repeating units is some equivalent resistance or infinite resistance, and then calculate it for this particular, you know, combination where you left that one unit, right, and that equivalent resistance. You will calculate for that unit and combination, and you would equate it to R infinite or R equivalent. And then you'd find out the value of R equivalent or R infinite. Okay, another such infinite resistor combination problem. Let's do a different kind of thing. This in fact appeared in one of your competitive exams. So it's 2R, and the combination is like, you know, like this, something here, there is an R, there is another R. But if you notice it, what is the repeating unit, guys? What is the repeating unit? Take a moment, have a look at this question, and think about the repeating unit. Which is the unit that is repeating, you know, like, it is repeating infinitely. So this is again an infinite, you know, combination. They can also call this like, you know, resistor leaders, or there might be different names, but they will definitely mention, you know, it's an infinite such resistors are repeating, or infinite resistors, or they may show it with a dot. Calculate, you know, the equivalent resistance of this combination. Take a moment, have a look at it. What is the thing that we have changed from earlier? See, you know the approach. If you are doing it well and good, you already know the approach. You're just not, you know, taking that initiative, if at all. Which is the repeating unit in this case? R and R. R, 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 R. Isn't it? And which is not repeating? These two are not repeating. Okay, 2R and R is not repeating. So you can't, you know, equate them. First, you need to assume this entire thing as. So you can, in an easier way, you can just break the problem and just keep the circuit aside for a little while and calculate the resistance for this circuit, for this infinitely repeating circuit or infinitely repeating units, and then go to that problem. You know, same way. And you already know the answer for this. We just did it. So this is going to be R into 1 plus under root 5 by 2. Okay. Same thing. You have to do, like, you know, R infinite and R in parallel, which has to be in series with another R, and where R infinite is the thing. If you didn't understand even a bit of this problem, go back to that problem, have a look at it, come back, this problem will become super easy. For now, just keep listening how you are solving this problem, and then you can go back. Okay. Now, that being said, the final answer would be something like this. For that repeating unit, where the problem is not yet solved. So there is 2R, R and another, like, infinite repeating unit for which we found the equivalent resistance. Okay, so it will look something like this. Final combination is R infinite over here, then there would be R over here, then there would be 2R over here. These two are in parallel. This R infinite and R are in parallel. And then this combination would be in series with this. Basically, some mathematics that you have to do once you understood the concept of the problem. So what would I do? I'll take like a parallel expression or a parallel combination of R infinite and R. That would come out to be R into 1 plus under root 5 divided by 2 into R by R into 1 plus under root 5 divided by 2 plus R. So 2 would get cancelled
and this will become 3r. So it will be 3 plus under root 5 by 2 on the denominator. On the numerator, what you are going to do is just take the r and cancel out the r on the denominator. And there would be an extra r left over because it's going to be r square. So this would be r over here
plus of 2r. 2r came from the series combination. Now this entire parallel combination, I mean this parallel combination is in series with 2r. So this would be the answer. You can further, you know, like reduce it and find out the value. That would be something like, you know, 6 plus 1, that is going to be 7 plus root 5 by 3 plus root 5 into r. But anyway, this is the method to approach any such infinite resistance problem. And remember that you may not be given r and 2r. You need to practice around this kind of problems, and especially infinite resistance problem, do practice on it. And you know, the beauty of this kind of problems, you'll get 1, 2 ohm, and such that you may not even have to get into like complicated roots sometimes. Maybe in IDJ you're not going to get, you know, like complicated roots. If at all you get it, well and good, just do it. And make sure, you know, understand the resistor combination problem. Okay, it should not take a lot of time to complete this kind of problems. It should be quick. Like resistor combination problem should be a scoring one, because it's going to be more of, you know, like understanding a little bit of concept, working more around the expressions and math. Basically, sometimes, you know, like you have to go through the logic, like how this resistance on all in infinite resistor combinations, basically math. Okay, don't make these mistakes. You know, draw an equivalent circuit. Try drawing an equivalent circuit every time you are moving through an equivalent circuit. Even while, you know, writing down, just draw the equivalent circuit that you know. Okay, easy. So that was the answer. But we just, you know, 7 plus 3 root 5 plus of divided by 3 plus root 5 into r. Another interesting problem. Actually, this should have been a confusing problem. Three identical resistors of 3 ohms are connected as shown in the figure. What is the total resistance of the circuit between 1 and ground? So this is 1 volt and this is ground. Guys, quick. This should be like something that you should answer within a moment. Like within a second, you should be able to answer this kind of questions. So given options are 3 ohms, 9 ohms, 1 ohm, 2 ohm, and 2 ohm. Okay. So what should be the final equivalent resistance? Each resistor is 3 ohms. This is 3 ohms, this is 3 ohms, this is 3 ohms. Don't you think all these 3 are in parallel? Draw current out of it. If it's easy to you, well and good. So if you draw current out of this, all this are parallel. So it should be 1 by 3 is equal to R equivalent. 1 by R equivalent. So R equivalent would be 3 by 3, 1 ohm. Easy? So guys, again, the strategy to play with, you know, these kind of problems, like normal series and parallel combinations, you do not have any equipotential point, or you know, you do not have a Wheatstone bridge. In those cases, you need to account those things first, and maybe assuming that, you know, you are not going through, you know, any symmetry methods. And symmetry methods can be used to solve problems quickly. Sometimes we'll discuss about it in the coming classes. But for now, this is the strategy to give given a problem. How do you solve it? You first draw the path of current. In fact, in Wheatstone bridge, if you draw the path of current, the current should not flow through the Wheatstone bridge, you know, that middle resistor. But anyway, so first you will draw, you know, the path of the current from point A to point B, from initial point A to B, for identifying whether which resistors are in parallel or series. And then what will you do is, on this path, you will solve for all series resistors first. You will first eliminate all the series resistors to make the circuit look neat and small. And then you will solve for the parallel resistors to make the circuit, you know, even better, like even smaller. And then you solve for the series. Again, then you solve for the parallel. So first you solve for the series, then you will come for the parallel, then you will come for the series, parallel, this way. But make sure you don't confuse yourself with series and parallel. That's more important. And you will get the solution. Alright guys, thank you so much for watching. It was an awesome lecture. We learned a lot of things. And guys, value the love, keep smiling and avoid gossip, and you have to work hard to achieve that success. Acquire the knowledge and share this channel and knowledge with everyone, guys. It's a free of cost channel made for everyone, so please do share this channel. And guys, you can get on our Telegram channel, https://t.me/je_english. If you have a Telegram app, else you have to download a Telegram app, and you'll get all updates that you want in time on our schedule, our lectures, on our notes, and also our video books, that is like our lectures that you're seeing right now. And guys, this Saturday we have something really, really special for you. That's our, you know, like special class on how to score 99 percentile and above in JEE Physics. And how do you attend this class? You need to get on to an Academy Learning app, and you know, you need to view this class from 4 to 6 p.m. on Saturday. Okay, guys. And the thing is, you need to install this app from Play Store or App Store. If you don't have it, if you have it, well and good. Just wait for the moment, and we will be discussing it soon. How to score 99 percentile and above in Physics. JEE Physics, and it's not a big deal. In fact, I'm going to talk about JEE Physics Advanced as well. Okay guys, it's pretty easy. You can do that. All you need is a strategy. You need to understand what's the syllabus and how to crack it, and you need to have a schedule in place. I have been talking about a few things now, and we will have a detailed discussion that day as well. And if you're preparing for tests, and if you're looking for some awesome test series or quizzes, you may want to, you know, choose your goal as IIT JEE if you're preparing for IIT JEE or other program accordingly, and get a subscription. And all you need to do is you need to get this premium subscription. Depending on your schedule or depending on like how long your journey is left over, you can choose the program. If you're 9th, 10th or 11th or 12th class, I would recommend that you get a 24-month subscription for your JEE preparation, and a 12-month subscription if you're in a long term, or if you're a dropout, and 1 and 3 month subscription if you're stuck in a lockdown. And you can apply the coupon code Murli Live to get a 10% instant discount. Alright guys, thank you, take care, bye bye, see you the next time with new concepts and even better, you know, like strategies to solve problems in combination of resistors.